Nisi and I have known each other for, I guess, about 5 years now. So it's, and I love her to death, so this is like a way to get going for me, and I'm actually kind of nervous. Nisi, that's our guest of honor. Please give her a round of applause. Y'all know who she is. That's a good thing because I didn't write an introduction. So, write something? So, I just wanted to kick right in, just have a nice little conversation with my good old friend here. So, there's one thing that's like really hard when I was just going over and thinking about your life and then going through all these interviews is like just coming up with like a consistent stream because you do so many things. So it's really hard to just go like, well, so this is point A to point B. So we're gonna go A, Z, and throw in a couple other ones, filling off the next and all that other stuff, and just see what kind of happens. So one of the first questions I have to ask, because this has been bugging me for years. my first introduction to you was The Good Boy, which we published in Mothership, which is an Afrofuturist tale with a lot of music in it. So I originally just kind of associate you with Earth, Wind, and Fire because of the song. And I know that you were in a punk band, which we're going to get to later. But the one thing that's been bugging me is, you guys don't know this, but this woman's a huge fan of Steely Dan. And I don't understand it. So, if we just start with, what's up with that?
It was actually a Rosarium project that got me interested again in Steely Dan. Back in the day, when they were like fresh and new, I was hanging out with a bunch of jazz musicians. And the jazz musicians were saying, you should really listen to this Asia album. Because that album has Wayne Shorter on it, for one. So, you know, they were not just soft rock, they were like jazz that was rock, or jazz with a rock beat, or I don't know. Anyway, so then I get asked to write an essay for, now what was that?
Shattered Prism.
Shattered Prism, right. So I wanted to think about how this was an international outreach. This magazine was a global phenomenon. So I listened to IGY by Donald Fagen from the Nightflyer album. Donald Fagen is one half of Steely Dan, the creepiest half.
Yeah.
He is. So IGY stands for International Geophysical Year. And the lyrics are like really ironic and catchy. It's talking about, you know, a train made of graphite and glitter, which is completely ephemeral and fits with the whole mood of this future that never was. So I listened to that, and then as happens with me, as has happened with Michael Jackson and Sandy Denny, I just sort of got obsessed, and I was watching videos of them on YouTube. Then I started writing stories based on their lyrics. I just read one, and as far as the creepiness of Donald Fagen, when he was 20, it was all right that he could only get it up for women 19 and younger, but he's 70. Now, something like that, and his love interests have not gotten any older.
So he's like the Woody Allen.
Except
I don't see what the dog.
It doesn't have to be related to him, right?
Well, that took a turn. wasn't really expecting that one. What were they called? Intersex?
Insects,
right. So, XEX. So, yeah, so tell me about your short punk career, because this is Because like the slits are one of my favorite groups of all time. Yeah.
Oh, I love the slits.
Yeah.
And, oh, sorry. but yeah, what did I do? I wrote songs. I wrote them on a guitar or on a toy piano. But I didn't play on stage. I was just like standing there belting out the lyrics, you know, swear words and all. I was wearing the torn clothes, the belt made out of safety pins and all that kind of stuff. I was really into the punk aesthetic because it was all about you can do this stuff yourself, which is completely opposed to Steely Dan, I realized. But, you know, you have to be able to do all of this stuff yourself and also admire people who can do other things. I was in that band. I was in another band that I started, Accidental Suitcase. We did covers of any band with an X in their name. So, X-Ray Specs, right? Polystyrene. We did covers of XTC. it kind of ended when the lead guitarist had a fight with me and she like tore off my dress. And, yeah.
Goodness, okay.
But it was punk.
How do you feel about lollipops? I'm like, no. So, like, so actually, this is I didn't even, well, I didn't write much down, but it's kind of interesting to me because you know we have like this whole Afro-punk festival.
Oh, cool.
Which isn't very much related to punk at all, and. But I think it's kind of interesting because it's sort of like this, it's not the punk aesthetic as far as like Johnny Rotten and like the Sex Pistols and all that stuff, but it's sort of like this whole redefining of oneself. Like not taking like these, the mediated norms of blackness and being constrained by them.
Okay.
So I was just thinking like it's kind of interesting that you actually were a punk.
I just Joe Strummer on the mouth. Ooh, yeah, Joe Strummer. Thank you. Yeah. So yeah.
I mean, that doesn't even matter, right?
Cuban music you can find in Congolese music first.
Yeah. So, do you have a go-to?
A go-to?
Let's say you have a writer's block, which I know you never did, but let's say you did. Like, who would be your...
What is that?
I don't know. I just like, I don't even spell block. But, like, do you have any go-to artists that you need to, like, inspire you to, like, who are you with your big inspirations now?
Actually, it's not just the artist, it's a particular CD that I listen to when I'm just like really, really depressed, utterly just floored, is Tranquility by Ahmad Jamal.
Pittsburgh, so.
Okay. I listened to it first when I was in college. It's not in print anymore, so I have to YouTube it, but just the second side of that. You know, I put it on and it's like Zen, it's like meditation. It is tranquility, and it gets rid of all my anxiety and self-doubt.
Okay, so we're going to move on to another topic. I'm sorry, I'm a big music fan, so I actually kind of wanted to just vibe on for a quick second. But one of the things that you're known for is Writing the Other, which is a manual that you wrote by Cynthia Ward.
Yeah.
So, one, I guess I'd like for you to explain to people what that is, and then what inspired you to actually, like, what was the need that you saw that inspired Writing the Other?
Okay, so Writing the Other, A Practical Approach, is a book that is not available in the bookshop here. but you can get it online. It's based on a bunch of lectures and exercises that Cynthia and Ward and I developed in response to a complaint of a classmate of ours. So flashback to 1992, Clary and Wes were sitting on the lawn outside our dorm, and one of the Clary and Wes writers, students, says, I would never write about someone from a different ethnic background than I have because I would get it horribly wrong. And I'm sitting there thinking, well, that's an easy out. You know, just don't do it and you'll never be wrong. And so I thought that, yes, it is a good idea to try and do it well, but that includes doing it. So I came up with strategies that I thought would work. I wrote an essay about it, then we taught some classes, then we wrote the book.
So
that encompasses both your questions, yes.
Yeah, yeah. And so with, like for me, you know, especially when I was a kid, you see the future, but you don't see any brown folks in it at all. I mean, I joke about it now as an adult because it's just like, you know, some horrible worldwide plague that killed all the melanin. it's called scarlet resistance. But what importance do you place on the idea of having some sort of representation, like in the future, in the past, wherever it is, just in the culture?
Well, it really changes the story, doesn't it? I mean, it changes how we see the story and how we see ourselves, and so it changes the story of the world. I do want to emphasize that Writing the Other is, you can think of representation as a bird. And so Writing the Other is one wing. And the other wing is the own voices, which is a movement that I did not start, that I don't have much to do with, but I do think we need both wings. So I want people to be able to write the kind of futures that reflect the diversity and inclusiveness of the present. And I also want people to be able to represent themselves.
So, so in a way, Do you look upon, you know, art as, well, because, you know, we don't, oftentimes you hear about art and, like, people think that it's not political or it shouldn't be political or whatever. So do you think that just, like, what you do, even if it's not overtly political as a political statement?
Well, okay, now I'm going to give away my age. The personal is political. The personal is political. What I do with this paper, with this plastic cup, that's political. There's a line that I had one of my characters say in Everfair. One character says, we never talked about politics. And the friend that he's talking to says, well, then you can talk about anything. Because it's politics is all it's about. It's just a way of looking at stuff.
So then if you actually do ever hear that complaint, what's your response? Just that? Is it something that...
Or maybe I don't say anything because like they're not worth the time.
I totally agree with that.
Just keep on making your mistake.
So then how do you guide somebody to write it? Do people just come up to you and go, like, I have this Slobovian character that I'm just obsessed with. Like, the drug dealer has to be Slobovian. And then you sit there and go, like, what do you know about Slobovian? Oh, that's a made up place, just in case you didn't know.
Guide anybody, they're all coming to me for guidance, right? I'm not like, you know, saying, come learn. They're all saying, hello, could I please learn? So, yeah, it's actually a need that other people feel, and then they come to me. I'm not, you know, I may once in a while say, that really stunk. That was really flat, and, you know, that was full of stereotypes, but do that because then I expect them to pay me money and to teach them.
So it's sort of like getting it wrong is sort of like pornography, you know when you see it.
Yeah.
So how do people know when they get it right? Just like people are wrong.
There's like a tiny little bell inside their head that goes off. Ding! And they know.
Okay. So you, now we can talk about it.
Okay.
So it started off as like you just like running them out. Is that what that was?
It pretty much was.
So
I wasn't even drunk.
So goodness, wait, please. Because I think it's funny that like an idea you force yourself into having this certain idea. So
basically. Yeah, as Jamie Goh said, I dared myself to do this. And I think Michael Swan would mention it in his essay too. Because he and I, and Liz Kurinsky, who was my editor for the project, and Anne Van Der Meer, and I can't remember her name, she was in Clockwork Phoenix, she's an Australian writer, Deborah Biancotti, yeah. So we were all on a panel at World Fantasy because I was there because I'd been nominated for a couple of awards, which I didn't win, but that's okay. Better things happen. But anyway, so we're on the panel and they asked me, you know, what it was I liked about steampunk, and I hated steampunk. And I told them, I told them that I had figured out in the course of coming to that panel why. That was because the steampunk that I was familiar with just supported and validated all sorts of colonialist narratives. And I had come up with two whole examples of fiction that didn't do that, one of which was published. A story by Nora Jemison that was not published at that time, The Affluent Engine, okay. And then a chapter of a Steve Barnes novel. The novel's called Zulu Park, and the part I considered non-colonialist steampunk was where this black, disabled teenage woman invents a submarine. So that, so I was like, so there's your two, and then there's everything else. And I just have this tendency to want to do things rather than just complain about them. So I said I would write a steampunk novel set in the Belgian Congo.
So why did you, because like that's one of the most horrific instances of, in the history
I've ever read. Yeah, that was an atrocity, yeah.
I mean, because the Congo's always been cursed with everything the West ever used, right? Like, it's just like, they needed ivory, they had rubber, slaves, diamonds, and now, like, our cell phones. Yeah, I mean, it's just like, every time you turn around, you're like, what do we need? And Congo's like, shit, we got it. So what made you decide on that particular instance in history?
Because it was so opposite the, here we go, have the merry adventure spirit that I found so objectionable. It was like, this is the grimness, this is the bloodiness, and so let's just wade right into that. And then as I say, Michael Swanwick rolled his eyes at me and said, well, I'm not going to read it. And so I said, I will make you beg to read it. And then I had to figure out how to do that. And the inspiration for How came from an article about a colony that Henry Ford started called Fordlandia. He started a colony in South America, a place where people would like grow rubber. And I was like, well, that's a capitalist thing. But what if there was actually a socialist one? So, there you go. That's how it started.
So, how long did it take?
6 years.
So in that research, like, what kind of, like, I mean, because, I mean, everything is utopia, and socialist.
Some people wanted it to be a utopia.
Right. But, I mean, it's like the place in a utopian idea. So then, like, where in all this, like, I don't know if anybody's read the history of the Congo, but it's, like, utterly insane. I mean, it's just, like, people dying in the roads and people getting their arms chopped off or not collecting enough rubber. I mean, it's just, like, one of the most horrific things that you can possibly read. And you know, it's what Belgium was built on, right? Like, we could go to Belgium and just name it Kinshasa and just, like, call it a day. Like, that's actually my dream, is to, like, go to Belgium and go, wow, the Congo looks great this time. what kind of like horrible, like how did you glean any kind of like hope or any kind of dream out of like this thing, that this history that you believe in?
I gleaned it in opposition to the history. That I knew that there were people who had been opposed to it. I read a book, which I highly recommend to you, called King Leopold's Ghost. It is a nonfiction about the actual Congo situation. There were people who made it their cause, and so those, they were my hope. The fact that most of them were outsiders caused the other conflict in the book, but I imported the hope.
So. Is this like one of the, especially for being a black writer, when we're delving into history, I don't know if you guys know this, but there's just like not that many happy endings to black history. I mean, there's really aren't, like people just end up dead. So like when you're writing an alternative history, like what is it, because I mean, what is it that you look to examine in that history that would pull a story like that? Does that make sense at all?
What is it that I...
It's sort of like, because everything, I mean, there's so many, like when Maurice brought us at The Voices of Martyrs, right? And we're doing all these, you know, speculative fiction stories and history, right? And it's just like this really depressing kind of process of just going through retelling these historical stories. But, I mean, for us, I think, like, a lot of times, not only do we want to recognize that sorrow or that pain, but we also want to say, like, there was hope in the survival, I guess you could say, or hope that they dreamt us up.
So, in my religion, I follow a West African tradition. There is a concept called redeeming the curse. And in redeeming the curse, you don't, like, just wipe the curse out. You make it part of the story, and you make it come out right. So that's what I try to do when I'm writing this alternate history is, you know, I have this horrible person, Leopold, who, by the way, in Everfair, he has no representation on the page at all. I did write a short story, a horror story with him in it, but in Everfair, he's not there. You have this horrible person, you have horrible things starting to happen, and then you have another force coming in and saying, let's bend that this way. Let's change that course of that river. That's what I try to do. And what historically happened is something that we need to know, but we also need to know what could have happened, what could have been, and what has the potential to have happened, because that influences what will happen as well as what will happen is influenced by what could have happened as well as what did happen.
So it's like, was it Wolina Marisha, when she said, like, why comes to science fiction, right?
Yes. Oh, she wrote that essay for Stories for Chip.
Yeah.
And she called herself and Adrienne Marie Brown, the co-editor, and a lot of the contributors to her anthology, which was
Octavia's
Group, yes. She called them walking science fiction because they were the science fictional fulfillment of their ancestors' speculation.
Right. And I'm just like, I'm really obsessed with that notion. Because, you know, as I tell people, it's like the most powerful power that humanity's ever known has been trying to kill us for 400 years and we're still here. And y'all still scared. and with that, like, for me, growing up, right, everybody said, like, you can't be a science fiction writer because, you know, black science fiction writers don't exist. But, like, when you're writing, you know, I mean, do you have those kind of notions in your head? Like, you're not just writing this aesthetic piece, but you're also writing, I guess, us into the future.
Well, me. I mean, okay, you too.
Not but, special. Go ahead.
Yeah, but me first.
Right? Yeah, no, it's totally fair. I'm interviewing you.
Yeah. No, but I mean, I'm sure that when you write, you are writing yourself into the future. I know that Octavia Butler, when she was writing science fiction, she specifically and explicitly said she was writing herself into the future. Sure. And if other people like me want to come along, great.
Okay, I have this quick question, and you don't have to. It was like, I didn't get to read it because it was a podcast, but this title, I was just curious about this Afro-retrofuturism. Like, I didn't even know what that was.
Okay, so it's a portmanteau word, as they say. There's retrofuturism, which is what steampunk sometimes calls itself. And retrofuturism meaning the kind of future that the past dreamed up for itself. And it's also the kind of future where past technology made the future. And then there's Afrofuturism, which we will not get into all the contending definitions, but basically... Afrofuturism basically... traditions, philosophy brought into the future.
So, because I remember, what was that, like 2013, 2012, where a bunch of us were sitting there and like Afrofuturism like was starting to like really bubble up, and like I remember a bunch of black writers going like, what? Like, what am I? What is this? So when you, and I was one of them. I was just like, what am I?
Because let's get into the history of where that term came from.
Right.
Mark Derry,
right,
a white academic, came up with it to explain the writing of Samuel R. Delaney. Who is here, right?
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, maybe not in this room, but he's at this convention. So it was already an outsider's gaze. It was a non-writer. It was someone who was not of that ethnic background. That was someone saying, I'm pointing at you.
Right?
Yeah.
I don't think you would
contest
that.
Right.
Yeah.
So that was Afrofuturism. And then Afro-retrofuturism to me is writing with African-derived values in a retrofuturist frame.
So where do you place yourself in that debate? Or whatever they call this. Because I mean, I realize now that with Black Panther, because I've been hearing things like white folks are just like putting some black guy in the middle of something and then just saying, hey, Afrofuturism. Like, where do you exactly? It happens. I mean, we didn't have the British invasion after all. I mean, this isn't new. but where do you actually like fit yourself, or do you even care like about that label?
Well, I mean, not Afrofuturism, but I did make up the label.
So that's what you're doing.
Yeah, that's what I'm doing. And I will call myself, I will say that I've written Afrofuturist fiction. I figure that if enough of us do that, then we will change the definition. And I think, actually, to get deep into the controversy that I just said I would get into. Nnedi Okorafor. Nnedi Okorafor, who is a science fiction writer, she started this kind of debate because she said that Afrofuturism should be composed mostly of writers, not just of the African diaspora, but actually situated currently on the African continent. By which definition, yeah, she was knocking herself out of the game.